Welcome to this unit, in which we're going to talk about the input capabilities of our operating system. And in particular, we're going to talk about a class called Keyboard that manages all the dialogue, if you will, between our computer and the physical keyboard. And if you recall, this is how we handle input-output devices on the HEC platform. This was covered in Nanto Tetris Part 1 and mentioned only also in module 0 of this course. So by convention, we allocate a certain space in the RAM to represent or stand for the screen, and likewise we allocate a single 16-bit register in the RAM to represent the keyboard. Now this 16-bit representation is all that is needed in order to represent any possible character in the Unicode character set, so this is sufficient for handling the keyboard. And this is called the keyboard memory map, which once again is a single RAM register. That's how it looks like using this graphical metaphor. So on the right hand side we see a keyboard which is identical, you know, more or less to the keyboard that you are currently using on your computer. And on the left we see this single RAM register that we discussed before, which we also call keyboard by convention. So here's the contract. When you press a certain key on the keyboard register works in such a way that it immediately and instantaneously displays the binary value of the scan code or the Unicode or the ASCII code that you have pressed. All these codes are the same within the subset of characters that are recognizable by the HEC computer. And so that's what happens when you press the keyboard. Once you release your finger and no key is pressed, the keyboard register is set to zero. So normally the keyboard register is zero because most of the time no one touches the keyboard, and in the few instances in which we touch the keyboard, we get some non-zero value reflected in this register. This contract is delivered by the hardware, and therefore we don't have to worry about it. And yet everything that we will do in the keyboard class of the operating system is going to be built on this very humble foundation. So let me illustrate to you how this thing works. Suppose I take my finger and press K. Now, as long as my finger is down on the K key, I'm going to see in the keyboard register the value of the scan code that represents K, which happens to be 75 in ASCII. So once again, as long as the finger is down, I'm going to be to see 75. Once I lift my finger off and nothing touches the keyboard, I'm going to see the default value, which is zero in the keyboard register. Now I take my finger again and touch four, you know, the key that represents the four digit. Now the ASCII code of four happens to be 52, and that's what I'm going to see in the keyboard register. Once I lift my finger, I'm going to see nothing, or zero. Put my finger again down, this time on space. As long as the finger is down on space, I'm going to see 32, which happens to be the ASCII value representing space. Lift my finger, I see zero. I put my finger down again, this time on the up arrow key. It so happens that the ASCII code of up arrow is 131, so I'm going to see this number in the keyboard register. Once again, I lift it up, I see zero, and so on and so forth. You got the idea. Now, with that in mind, here is the complete character set that the HEC computer recognizes. What you see here is a table, which I split into several columns to make it easier to follow. On the left column, you see the name of the character. It's an agreed upon name. And on the right hand side, you see yet another agreed upon code that represents this character using some integer value. Taken together, all these characters are the Heck Jack character set. So now that we understand the notion of characters, let's move on and talk about the keyboard class. We have chosen to base this class on four subroutines, and here they are. There's no need to read the documentation because we're going to delve and into every one of these subroutines and implement it carefully. But basically, KeepRest is designed to capture, you know, one the event of pressing a key on the keyboard. ReadCar is designed to capture the event of reading a character from the keyboard. And then we have ReadLine, which reads a string up to an enter or carriage return character. And finally, ReadInt does the same, but interprets what it read as an integer. And taken together, this is the API of our keyboard adapter or our keyboard class. And so let's go on and begin to implement this class, starting with KeepRest. KeepRest is quite trivial. If a keyboard key is pressed, we return the scan code of that key, else we return zero. You may be guessing how to implement it, and if not, we'll discuss it later when we talk about our implementation notes. So this is the most primitive function or input function in the operating system. And notice that this is kind of it's a real-time listener kind of a function. In other words, when you invoke it, what you get is what is currently being pressed on the keyboard in this very instant of time in which you invoke this method. And so it operates on a sort of a blink of a second. You know, you call this method, it returns a value, and that's it. So it's the most real-time function that you can think of. Now, ReadCar is quite different. Okay, the ReadCar function has persistence. It returns the key that was last pressed by the user. And notice that this is very different from KeepRest, and I'll try to explain why. Once again, KeepRest is a real-time operation, and yet, suppose I write a program that puts a string on the screen saying something like, press a key. I tell the user to press a key. So now, I have to wait and see what the user will do. See, that's what ReadCar does. Now, first of all, the user, may not be willing to cooperate. Maybe he saw this prompt, press the key, and he decided to go and get himself a cup of coffee. So by the time he returns, or she returns, 10 minutes have passed, and they haven't yet pressed the key. And then all of a sudden they press the key. Now I'm exaggerating, but even in real key presses, one key press, it might take a few milliseconds here and a few milliseconds there. Different users react, have different response times. So at some point, the user is going to press the key. And then we also have no idea how long the user will be willing to leave his or her finger on the keyboard. Maybe they enjoy putting their fingers for a few seconds. Maybe they lift the keyboard, their fingers immediately. So once again, we don't know. So we see that ReadCar has to overcome or handle two sources of uncertainty. How long it takes before the user obliges and presses the key, and how long it takes before the user is willing to remove his or her finger. So how do we handle it? We have to neutralize these uncertainties. So first of all, we display the cursor. If you want to be nice, we want to show the user where actually on the screen they will see the feedback of what they pressed. And then we have to wait until a key is pressed. Now, the most natural way to do it is to use this strange-looking while loop. And basically, we say that as long as KeyPress is zero, we do nothing. So if you think about it, all the action of this loop is actually in the condition. The condition here is very active because the condition calls the KeyPress function for its effect, And it does it in this loop, which may well be infinite if the user is not going to press anything. And so this loop essentially amounts to sampling the keyboard. We sample the keyboard until something happens. Now, when something happens, key press will not be zero any longer. So we're going to be ejected outside this while loop. And then we can finally capture the key that the user has pressed. We put it in some variable that I called C. And now remember, the finger is down. So the finger is down, and we don't know for how long. So we are going to wait until the key is released, and we'll do it using a very similar loop so that as long as the finger is down, we do nothing. Okay? And once the finger goes up, key press will become again zero, and then we can finally give the user some feedback on what he or she pressed and return C to the caller. So once again, I hope that you appreciate the difference between read car and key pressed and understand that we need read car to overcome these uncertainties that we cannot control. Well, actually, we do control them quite nicely, but within the program level. And then the next method or function that I'd like to discuss is reading a string. And recall that, you know, typically when we ask the user to enter something like enter your name or enter your age, we expect the user to enter several keys, not one, several keys like, you know, the name Peter or 53 or whatever. And normally, we expect the user to signify that the input has been completed by entering enter, or sometimes call it return. So we have to write some logic to handle this kind of user behavior. And that's what readline is doing in the OS keyboard API. So we're going to build a string, right? That's the string that the user is entering, and we'll start with null. And then we're going to enter some repeat loop in which we're going to grow the string according to the keystrokes that the user is submitting. So first of all, you know, we read a character. And notice the beauty of this abstraction. You know, we say read car, but we know that we've completely handled all the drama of putting the finger down, putting the finger up. All this is encapsulated by read car. We took care of it. So we read a character, and then we want to look at this character and check what it is. So if the character is new line, which is the ASCII code of the enter key, or you know whatever is this key on your keyboard, then we want to display new line and return the string. Now, displaying new line, you know, is not our business. This is something which is done by the output class. So we have to call the output method that displays a new line. You can check the output API how to do it. And this will cause the cursor, you know, to go to the next line. And by then we know that the str, the string, has been entered, so we simply return it. So that's the end of the process. Now, another possibility is backspace. If the user has entered backspace, then we know that the character that was last entered should be erased. So we remove the last character of str, and then we also want to acknowledge the fact that the user has pressed backspace, and we do it by calling the output backspace function. And this function, which we discussed in the previous unit, knows how to move the cursor one position backward. But you know, that's not our business. Output is going to do it for us. So these are the two kind of extreme possibilities of entering characters. And if it's not enter and it's not backspace, then presumably we have a bona fide character. We have a real character to work with. So we take this character and we append it to str. And that's the end of the logic here. We keep on doing this, and notice that the only way to get out of this loop is to encounter a new line, which is exactly what we wanted. And when this happens, we return str. So that's the function for reading lines from the keyboard. So having described the logic of these functions, I'd like to give you some hints on how to implement them on the Hack platform. So beginning with the keypressed. Well, keypressed can be very easily implemented using memory peek. If you recall, we have a function called peek that allows you to get into any register in the RAM and return its value. Well, one of these registers happened to keep the current contents of the keyboard. So, you know, take it from here, and I'm sure that you know how to you will know how to implement it. Okay, what about read car? Well, read car, simply implement the pseudo code that I showed you in the previous slide, and likewise read line, you can implement the same the pseudo code of read line. And finally, we have read int, and read int is a function which is quite similar to read line, except that we expect the user to enter digits only. And as we read these digits, we build an integer from them. And once again, this is logic that you should be able to write on your own using the guidelines that we gave you before. So these are all the necessary implementation notes for writing the keyboard class. And with that, we have completed all these classes in the operating system. And we are ready to move on and talk about string processing.